Now we are going to use this knowledge about pharmacokinetics and optimal sensing to perform real therapeutic drug monitoring. Therapeutic drug monitoring is goal-oriented and model-based. Goal-oriented means that you define your therapeutic goals. Model-based means that you use a population pharmacokinetic model for your first dose and fill in the variables you know. And therapeutic drug monitoring is the use of Bayesian techniques to individualize with as little as possible sampling your population pharmacokinetic model to calculate a reliable individual dose advice. Here you see it schematically. You start with your patient data. You have your pharmacokinetic model, your therapeutic goals, and your dosing algorithm. Then you calculate your first dose to start with. Then you draw your blood samples and measure your serum concentrations. You add these data to your pharmacokinetic model, and with your therapeutic goals, you recalculate the dose to further individualize the dose for your patient. And this circle is repeated as long as necessary or as long as therapy takes. Back to the example of the aminoglycosides. For the therapeutic drug monitoring of aminoglycosides, you need knowledge. Knowledge about the pharmacodynamics of these antibiotics, knowledge about the pharmacokinetics of these antibiotics, and then you do a smart integration of pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics. The integration of pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics gives you the opportunity to design optimal dosing regimens for patients. On the one hand, you have your pharmacokinetic input. On the other hand, you have your pharmacodynamic input. With the aid of a pharmacokinetic pharmacodynamic model, you can calculate your dosing regimen. You need to know the basic principles of the working mechanism of antibiotics. Whether, like aminoglycosides and fluoroquinolones, the bacterial killing rate is dependent on the local concentration, or in case of the beta-lactams, there's a kind of ceiling effect of the killing rate with increasing concentration. Here you see the basic pharmacodynamic principles for a few classes of antibiotics. In case of the aminoglycosides, the efficacy relates on the ratio of the peak concentration of the drug divided by the MIC, that's the minimal inhibitory concentration for the particular microorganism. For the beta-lactams, clindamycin, erythromycin and linezolid, the efficacy depends on the time the concentration of the drug is above the MIC. And for azithromycin, the quinolones and vancomycin, the efficacy depends on the value of the 24 hours AUC divided by the MIC. Here you see the relationship between the concentration of an aminoglycoside and the bacterial killing in an infected animal. The filled circles are the control animals, and the other circles represent a maximum concentration, which is a quarter of the MIC. Those are the light circles. Then the triangles, once the MIC and 4 times the MIC, and the squares, 16 times the MIC and 64 times the MIC. You see, with increasing concentration, the efficacy of the drug also increases. Also in human studies, a relationship between the maximum concentration and the efficacy has been described. In the table on the left hand, you see that patients with initial peak levels below 5 micrograms per milliliter, 21% died and 79% survived, and patients with peak levels above 5 micrograms per milliliter, only 2% died and 98% survived. And in the figure on the right hand, you see that with an increasing peak MIC ratio, the response rate, that's the cure rate of an infection, increases with increasing ratio. However, these drugs are not only very effective, but also very toxic. In this study, you see animals that were treated with gentamicin, natamycin and tobramycin, and you see that the gentamicin and natamycin treated animals in 7 days lost about half of their renal function, and that the tobramycin treated animals had lesser renal toxicity. Let's present the case of a patient that was treated with tobramycin. This patient is a male patient, 55 years old, 1 meters 86, 75 kilograms. He is dehydrated and has a creatinine concentration of 101 micromole per liter. He has a pulmonary infection that needs treatment with tobramycin. Now you have to calculate the first dose and dosing interval. What do you need? You need a pharmacokinetic model. You need a pharmacodynamic model. So you can calculate your target concentrations. For the pharmacokinetic model, we don't have individual data yet. So we take population data. The population volume of distribution is 0.25 to 0.3 liters per kilogram body weight. Our patient is dehydrated, so we take the lower value. For the pharmacodynamics, we have no culture results yet, so we take the worst case. For tobramycin, the worst case MIC level is 2 milligrams per liter. So now we can calculate our a priori dose. The Cmax, this is the maximum concentration, must be about 8 to 10 times the MIC. The MIC is maximal 2 milligrams per liter, and the volume of distribution is 0.25 liters per kilogram. So we can calculate the dose. The dose equals the volume of distribution times the Cmax. That is 75 times 0.25 times 8 times 2, resulting in 300 milligrams, the lower dose, or 75 times 0.25 times 10 times 2 is 375, the upper range of the dose. We also have to calculate the a priori dosing interval. Tobramycin levels needs to drop below 0.5 milligrams per liter before the next dose is given because of its toxicity. Tobramycin is renally cleared. In case of a normal renal function, its half-life is 3 to 4 hours. And in 6 half-lives, the levels drop from 20 to less than 0.5 milligrams per liter. To calculate the renal function, we use the formula of Cockcroft and Gold depicted at the lower side of this slide. The GFR, that's the glomerular filtration rate, equals 140 minus the age times the body weight divided by 0.815 times the serum creatinine concentration, and this multiplied with 0.85 if the patient is a female. So for the renal function, with an age of 55 years, a body weight of 75 kilograms, and a male gender, we calculate a GFR of 77.4 milliliters per minute. And more than 60 milliliters per minute is seen as normal. So for this patient, our calculations result in an a priori dose of 300 to 375 milligrams once every 24 hours. And the physician starts with 1 times daily, 320 milligrams, because of the dehydration of the patient. Using average population pharmacokinetic parameters, for this patient, this dosing scheme of 1 times daily, 320 milligrams, will result in this concentration time relationship. Next, serum levels are drawn. Suppose that 1 hour after start, the peak level is drawn, which is 70 milligrams per liter. Then About 10 hours after start of treatment, a second level is drawn, which is about 4.5 milligrams per liter. And in this slide, you see the population graph together with the actually measured serum concentrations, and you see that the actually measured serum concentrations are a bit higher than expected. Next, you perform your Bayesian calculation to calculate the most probable individual pharmacokinetic parameters. Your Bayesian calculations result in a volume of distribution which is a bit lower than average, 0.22 liters per kilogram body weight, and an elimination rate lower than expected, which results in a half-life of 5.2 hours. Your conclusion of these data are that the peak level is a bit too low but acceptable because the target is 16 to 20 milligrams per liter and the actual level is 17 milligrams per liter, but the trough level is too high. A too high trough level results in renal toxicity. So the dose is right, but dosage interval is too short. And in this graph you can see that when you increase the dosing interval to 36 hours, levels have dropped to safe levels for redosing. For a good TDM surface, you need to organize a full process. At first, the physician decides to give a drug. The nurses have to prepare the drug and do the administration. You need to have a trigger to draw blood samples for therapeutic drug monitoring. Then the blood samples need to be drawn. You need to organize the transport of the samples to the laboratory in time, and that analysis is performed in time. The pharmacist needs to know the dose, the patient characteristics, the dosing times, and the times of the blood sampling to do his calculations. He needs to do the pharmacokinetic calculations on the same day to have a dose advice before the next dose can be administered. You have to organize an electronic reporting system of your results and your advice. And the physician needs to be alert for the results and the dosing advice. Next, we'll discuss the particular problems you encounter when you want to perform therapeutic drug monitoring of drugs, and especially the aminoglycosides, in neonates. A normal baby usually is between the 3 and 4 kilograms, but neonates can be as little as half a kilo to a kilogram. Children are not little adults. Children develop rapidly in the first weeks after birth, and it's important that you have knowledge about these changes. The most important antibiotics that are used in neonates are amoxicillin, gentamicin, vancomycin, fluoxacillin, and meropenem. In neonates, the MIC for gentamicin susceptible microorganisms is usually maximal 1 mg per liter. With a target Cmax of 10 times the MIC, we aim at 10 mg per liter. Trough levels are insufficiently investigated. In practice, we aim at a value of 0.5 to 1 mg per liter. Pharmacokinetics of gentamicin rapidly change after birth. Compared to adults and adolescents, preterm neonates have a much higher volume of distribution for gentamicin. You see a level of 0.5 to 0.7 liters per kilogram. For term neonates, the value is a bit lower, 0.4 to 0.6 liters per kilogram. You also see a change in half-life of this drug. Where adults and adolescents have a half-life of 2 to 4 hours, preterm neonates have a half-life of 8 to 12 hours. When you're dosing drugs to neonates, you on the one hand must give a higher dose per kilogram body weight because of a higher volume of distribution, and on the other hand you must take a longer dosing interval because of their poorer clearance and longer half-life. Dosing schemes for gentamicin in neonates have changed in the last decade. In the past, 2 to 2.5 milligrams per kilogram body weight every 18 hours was given, and it has developed to 5 milligrams per kilogram body weight every 36 hours. A study performed in the Juliana Children's Hospital in The Hague has shown that when you give 5 milligrams per kilogram body weight every 36 hours, only in 55% of the cases a dose adjustment had to be performed, which is less than the other dosing schemes. In this graph you see the value of the peak level when you give a child 5 milligrams per kilogram body weight every 36 hours. The black bars are the premature neonates. The distribution of the peak level is a bit to the left, resulting in a bit lower value than in the gray bars, which are the mature neonates, who have a bit higher peak level, which reflects the higher volume of distribution in the premature neonates compared to the mature neonates. There are several points of attention when you perform therapeutic drug monitoring in neonates. Basically, you use the same principles, but there are some important points of attention. First, the size of the blood sample. From neonates you can draw only several microliters. Instead of 1 milliliter, you can easily draw from an adult. Your analytical method must be sensitive enough for the small samples. Also, the number of blood samples is limited you can draw from a neonate. And neonates have rapidly changing pharmacokinetics of our drugs. So you use smart techniques to perform your therapeutic drug monitoring. The next point I want to discuss with you is how do you do therapeutic drug monitoring during home intravenous antibiotic treatment of our patients, for example those with cystic fibrosis. First, what is cystic fibrosis? Cystic fibrosis is a monogenetic disease. Patients have poor or not functioning or absent CFTR, and CFTR means cystic fibrosis transmembrane regulator, and that's caused by mutations in the CFTR gene. A CFTR mutation is a recessive mutation. When two parents have this mutation and they meet, there's a chance in 1 of 4 that they get a child with CF. CFTR is the cystic fibrosis transmembrane conductance regulator. It's a chloride channel, and mutations in this gene makes that this channel is less permeable for chloride ions. That means that there's no reabsorption of sodium chloride, and this results in high concentrations of salt in sweat and in lungs. The disease cystic fibrosis is characterized by obstruction of the gastrointestinal tract, which results in meconium in ileus after birth. Further, there is viscous mucus in the lungs, which results in bacterial colonization and infection. There's pancreatic insufficiency, which results in no or less production of pancreas enzymes, resulting in diabetes. There's liver cirrhosis. There's malnutrition. There's loss of salt. There's metabolic alkalosis, and there's male infertility. Most important is the viscous mucus in the airways. This results in bacterial colonization, first intermittently, then chronic. Then chronic infection of the lungs. There is a local inflammatory response by the tissue in the lung. There's destruction of pulmonary tissue, and this deterioration of the pulmonary function. The airway infection needs treatment with antibiotics. Antibiotics aiming against Staphylococcus aureus, Haemophilus influenzae, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, and Burkholderia sepacea. We can also use mucus dissolvers, like recombinant human DNAs, to dissolve the thick mucus. We can use drugs that inhibit inflammatory responses from the tissue, like ibuprofen. We can use stimulators or potentiators of ion channels. Those are new drugs that improve the function of the CFTR. In theory, we can give gene therapy, but that's not a success yet. And finally, we can offer our patients a lung transplantation. Antibiotic treatment is one of the mainstay treatments in cystic fibrosis. It's a lifelong treatment because there's a chronic colonization of the lungs. The most occurring microorganism is Pseudomonas aeruginosa, and the cornerstone of the therapy is a chronic inhalation with anti-Pseudomonas antibiotics such as tobramycin and colistin. Sometimes patients have exacerbations, that means that they temporarily get worse. Then they need treatment with intravenous anti-Pseudomonas antibiotics such as piperacillin, ceftazidime, tobramycin, aztreonam or colistin. And due to antibiotic treatment, median life expectancy has increased from 6 months in 1959 to now almost 37 years in the US. At this moment, many CF patients receive home intravenous treatment. The advantage, of course, is that the patient doesn't have to stay in the hospital, that treatment can be initiated earlier, and there's a low risk of hospital associated infections, and is also cheaper than an admission to the hospital. A disadvantage is that infusions need to be prepared by community pharmacists who do not always have the expertise or equipment to perform this. And if the patient is treated with aminoglycosides, the therapeutic range of tobramycin is very small, and the patient has a high chance for irreversible toxicity, which is difficult to manage at home. The Dutch Foundation for Cystic Fibrosis advocates home intravenous treatment and supports the development of an assay that's suitable for home monitoring of tobramycin in these patients. An assay has to be developed, has to be validated, and has to be implemented in clinical practice. And I will show you an example of this. Here's a graphical representation of the principle of home monitoring of tobramycin. The patient gets an portable infusion pump. The first dose of tobramycin is prescribed in the hospital. In the hospital, the dose is optimized using therapeutic drug monitoring. Then the patient is discharged and can go home, and the community pharmacist provides infusions for 1 week of treatment. Then the patient draws blood samples and sends it to the laboratory. The samples are analyzed and the dose is adjusted, and the physician describes the new dose. And the circle is round because the community pharmacist provides new infusions for the next week of treatment. What kind of blood samples can a patient draw by itself and send to the laboratory? That's not a normal vena puncture. It's different. We use the dry blood spots for this occasion. Tobramycin dose and target levels in cystic fibrosis are rather high. The dose is 10 mg per kilogram body weight, and the target levels are at peak level immediately after administration of 25 to 30 mg per liter, and the trough level immediately before the next dose of less than 0.2 mg per liter. Because the doses are rather high and the levels are rather strict, patient needs close monitoring, which is done by using of a so-called blood spot kit. The patient receives a blood spot kit, and the patient pricks himself in the finger, and a drop of blood is collected on a special piece of filter paper. The filter paper is dried and sent in an envelope to the laboratory. In the laboratory, the blood spot is analyzed and the concentration of the drug is measured and reported to the physician with a dose advice. Here you see a blood spot kit. Left is the ordering form. At the right you see an envelope, a special piece of paper with a few circles where you can put a drop of blood in, and the lancet to prick yourself in your finger. Here you see the blood lancet. First it must be activated. It is placed against the top of the middle finger. A button is pressed and a small needle pricks the finger and makes a little wound. A drop of blood is produced and the patient has to let it fall into a circle on the cards. This way two circles have to be filled. The paper is dried, put in an envelope and sent to the laboratory. In the laboratory, with a special machine, small rounds are punched out of the circles of the blood-stained paper. The circle is collected into a tube and an extraction fluid is added to extract the drug. The analysis of a drug in a dry blood spot is problematic. There are no assays commercially available for drugs in dry blood spots. You have to develop these assays yourself in your own laboratory, because commercially available assays for serum are not sensitive enough for the small volumes as collected in a dry blood spot. Other problems you will encounter when you develop an assay for a dry blood spot is: which filter paper do you have to use, and how reproducible is the blood spot itself? What's the size? Can the drug be extracted from the filter paper? Can the drug be separated from other components which are eluting from the paper? Can the drug be quantified? What's the effect of the hematocrit? What analytical techniques can be chosen to analyze the drugs from a dry blood spot? As already said, normal commercially available assays like the immunoassays are not suitable for blood spots. The best option is an LC-MSMS. You need HPLC to separate tobramycin or another drug from other serum components, and you use the mass selective detection to be able to measure sensitive and without much interference from other components. Here you see a picture of an LC-MSMS. At the left side you see the HPLC and on the right side you see the mass selective detector. The LC-MSMS technique is highly selective and very sensitive. The sensitivity is about 0.1 times 10 to the minus 9th gram of substance, 0.1 nanogram. Normal blood concentrations are 0.1 to 30 milligrams per liter. So in a blood spot of 10 to 20 microliters, there's 1 to 300 nanograms of substance which can easily be measured using this sensitive machine. When you develop an assay for yourself, you have to carry out a full validation. And you have to compare the results of the blood spot with the results that are produced with a normal venipuncture. So we did. Patients were asked to produce a blood spot when they were normally sampled for routine tobramycin monitoring in the hospital. And we simulated sample stability during transport via the mail. And in this figure you see the relationship between the tobramycin concentration measured by blood spot on the horizontal axis and the tobramycin concentration measured by an immunoassay in a sample that was drawn at the same time at the blood spot. There's an excellent correlation between both results. When you closely look at those results, you see that the serum concentration is twice as high as the blood spot concentration, and that's the effect of an unequal distribution of the drug between the plasma and the red blood cells, so-called hematocrit effect. The development of a blood spot assay has certain advantages. The patient doesn't need to go to the hospital for blood sampling. It's less traumatic than a venipunction. And of course it facilitates home intravenous treatment with drugs that need to be monitored. On the other hand, there are also some disadvantages. It's only suitable for certain drugs. Drugs, for example, need to be stable to air and cannot be irreversibly bound to filter paper. And also urgent samples are not possible because they have to be sent by mail. Therapeutic drug monitoring costs a lot of time in the hospital. What is the added value? The added value is the cost effectiveness of a methodology. There are two ways to study the cost effectiveness of therapeutic drug monitoring. On the one hand, patient-oriented, what percentage of patients on TDM was treated better or with less side effects compared to patients that were not monitored by TDM. Or it can be system-oriented, surrogate endpoints. What percentage of patients on TDM had serum concentrations in the therapeutic range compared with patients not on therapeutic drug monitoring? This needs the assumption that the therapeutic range is equivalent with a better outcome. One of the first studies to the impact of therapeutic drug monitoring on the clinical outcomes was performed in the Netherlands at the end of the previous century. The study protocol consisted of two groups of patients. The first group was a non-guided therapeutic drug monitoring group, that means regular TDM on the initiative of the physician. The other group was an active guided therapeutic drug monitoring. That means that the patients were closely monitored by the hospital pharmacist and immediately after the first dose, samples were drawn for therapeutic drug monitoring. In this graph, you see a Kaplan-Meier curve of both groups. The yellow line is the group that was non-guided, so on the initiative of the physician, and the blue line is the actively guided TDM group. On the horizontal axis, you see the time the patient spent in the hospital, and on the vertical axis, the percentage of patients. And on average, the actively guided TDM group spent a shorter time in the hospital than the non-guided groups. This is a sub-selection of patients who developed their infection in the hospital, so they were already admitted and developed their infection during admission. Again, on the horizontal axis, the time spent in the hospital, on the vertical axis, the percentage of patients, the yellow line, the control group with the non-guided therapeutic drug monitoring, and the blue line, the intervention group, who received active therapeutic drug monitoring. And you see a higher number of patients that died in the non-guided group and a much shorter stay in the hospital in the intervention group. From this study, several conclusions can be drawn. The therapeutic drug monitoring of the aminoglycosides gives a reduction of hospital stay in all patients, and there's a marked reduction of the hospital stay in patients who have acquired their infection in the hospital. And also, there's less mortality in patients who acquired their infection in the hospital. So on average, therapeutic drug monitoring is beneficial to patients.